Good morning and welcome to First Lutheran Church, where we gather to worship together as God's people. We come together to pray, to sing, to hear God's word, to confess our sins, and to eat a meal together on occasion. We are glad that you are joining us and hope that your life will be blessed by the time that you spend worshiping with us. If you'd like myself, Pastor Naomi, or Pastor Jim to come to your home, to your apartment, to your room, please give the church office a call, and we'll be more than happy to come and visit you. Thank you for being with us today, and God's blessings. Good morning, and welcome to worship. It is good to have all of you here as we gather this morning to sing, to pray, to hear God's word, share a meal, and celebrate a baptism, which we don't often do at this service, so that's a great celebration. There are a lot of things about our life together in your bulletin and on your green sheet. Most notably is we're coming to the end of our liturgical year, and we will be starting our Advent journey in a couple of weeks. Please take note of when Cantata and the Journey of Faith program and practices and all those kinds of things as they pertain to you. Also, Kurt Nodoff, where did you go? Oh, you're right up in front. No wonder I missed you. I got it, okay. Kurt will be in the back, once again, signing people up for gifts. We do need some overnight people, so I would ask that you prayerfully consider that. That does kind of need to be a man. We don't often mean do things gender specific, but that kind of does need to be a male type of person. So anyway, take note of that and think about how you can prayerfully be part of the gifts program. Pastor Jim is gone today. His father-in-law's funeral was yesterday. We had one on Thursday at Cedar Crest and then yesterday in Iowa. And then he'll be gone the next 2 weeks. He had a long vacation planned since last March, and so you won't see him around here for a little while. I believe those are announcements today, so I invite you to stand as we begin with our confession and forgiveness as it is printed in your bulletins. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose name is majestic in all the earth, who rescues and heals in every time of trouble, who does all things well. Amen. Let us come before God seeking forgiveness and life. Steadfast and saving God, have mercy on us. We confess to you all the ways we turn from you and harm one another. In your compassion, forgive our sins and heal our hurts. Bring forth from us love and joy, gentleness and peacemaking, wisdom and justice. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. In the name of Jesus, the Son of God, receive mercy. Find grace in your time of need. Your sins are forgiven. God's love is healing for all your wounds. Rejoice, for God raises you up to new life in Christ. Amen. We sing together.
Kyrie, found on page 138 in the front part of your books. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Let us pray. O God, where hearts are fearful and constricted, grant courage and hope. Where anxiety is infectious and widening, grant peace and reassurance. Where impossibilities close every door and window, grant imagination and resistance. Where distrust twists our thinking, grant healing and illumination. Where spirits are daunted and weakened, grant soaring and strengthen our dreams. All these things we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Please be seated.
Our first reading this morning is from the 12th chapter of Daniel, verses 1 through 3. At that time, Michael, the great prince, the protector of your people, shall arise. There shall be a time of anguish, such as never occurred since nations first came into existence. But at that time, your people shall be delivered. Everyone who is found written in the book, many of those who sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake to everlasting life, and some to shame and everlasting contempt. Those who are wise shall shine like the brightness of the sky, and those who lead many to righteousness like the stars forever and ever.
Our psalm this morning is, "There's a Longing in Our Hearts." If you look in your bulletin towards the back, there's a refrain. We will sing the refrain, and Jan will sing the verses.
There is a longing in our hearts, O Lord, Comfort, hear our prayer. In weakness, in fear, be near, hear our prayer, O God. There is a longing in our hearts, O Lord, for you to reveal yourself to us. There is a longing in our hearts for love we only find in you, our God. For healing, for wholeness, for new life, hear our prayer. In sickness, in death, be near, hear our prayer, O God. There is a longing in our hearts, O Lord, for you to reveal yourself to us. There is a longing in our hearts we only find in you, our God. Lord, save us, take pity, light in our darkness. We call you, we wait, be near, hear our prayer, O God. There is a longing in our hearts, O Lord, for you to reveal yourself to us. There is a longing in our hearts for love we only find in you, our God.
Our second reading is from the 10th chapter of Hebrews. And every priest stands day after day at his service, offering again and again the same sacrifices that can never take away sins. But when Christ had offered for all time a single sacrifice for sins, he sat down at the right hand of God, and since then has been waiting until his enemies will be made a footstool for his feet. For by a single offering, he has perfected for all time those who are sanctified. And the Holy Spirit also testifies to us, for after saying, "This is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, says the Lord. I will put my laws in their hearts, and I will write on them on their minds." He also adds, "I will remember their sins and their lawless deeds no more." Where there is forgiveness of these, there is no longer any offering for sin. Therefore, my friends, since we have confidence to enter the sanctuary by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain, that is, through his flesh, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us approach with a true heart in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who has promised is faithful. Let us consider how to provoke one another to love God and good deeds, not neglecting to meet together as has been the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and for all the more as you see the day approaching. Here ends the reading.
Thank you, Chuck. Our gospel for this 25th Sunday in Pentecost comes from Mark, the 13th chapter, and I invite you to stand for the reading. As Jesus came out of the temple, one of his disciples said to him, "Look, teacher, what large stones and what large buildings." Then Jesus asked him, "Do you see these great buildings? Not one stone will be left here upon another. All will be thrown down." When he was sitting on the Mount of Olives opposite the temple, Peter, James, John, and Andrew asked him privately, "Tell us, when will these things be? And what will be the sign that all these things are about to be accomplished?" Then Jesus began to say to them, "Beware that no one leads you astray. Many will come in my name and say, 'I am he,' and they will lead many astray. When you hear of wars and rumors of wars, do not be alarmed. This must take place, but the end is still to come. For nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. There will be earthquakes in various places. There will be famines. This is but the beginning of the birth pains." This is the gospel of our Lord. You may be seated. Let us pray. Lord, make us instruments of your peace. Where there is hatred, let us sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is discord, union. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. Where there is sadness, joy. Grant that we may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. Amen. There are certainly some weeks when I think that the Holy Spirit has a sense of humor. The readings that have been read for today were the ones assigned for today. And the bulletins were printed before we heard the news. There's no doubt in the last 48 hours I have rewritten this sermon. It seems as if this passage from Mark was written for this past week in the world. Nation against nation, kingdom against kingdom, earthquakes, famine, and it is just the beginning of the birth pains. Bombings and gunmen in Beirut and Baghdad. More and more refugees fleeing Syria, trying to find a new home. Earthquakes in Japan and Mexico, and massive mudslides in China. And then, if that wasn't enough, an orchestrated attack on the city of Paris has left us, the world, reeling. It is as if reckless abandon has taken over. Gandhi says, "When I despair, I remember that all through history, the way of truth and love have always won. There have been tyrants and murderers, and for a time they seem invincible, but in the end, they always fall." Think of it, always. The book of Mark is the first of the Gospels to be put together following the life of Jesus. And it was written about the year 70 AD, after the temple in Jerusalem had been destructed. Mark was writing to people in despair and agony and disbelief. They couldn't believe this temple, this place that they called home, who had been built so many years ago with massive, massive stones. And if you've ever been there, you know they are huge. It was an accomplishment to build the temple. It was almost more of an accomplishment to tear it down. So Mark was writing to these people who were reeling, who were wondering what is next. And he was writing to tell them the story of Jesus and the gospel of love and hope he brought into the world, even when their world seemed to be falling apart. He was writing to remind the people that there is one God And Jesus shows us the way to that God. He was writing so people would not follow false teachers, because that's our tendency, is when we are grasping about for reasons why and looking for answers, we grasp at anything, including false teachers. He was writing in times of confusion. Sort of sounds familiar to our week in the world. It was a time of reckless abandon. One of my favorite passages, I know I say that often, but one of my favorite passages in the Bible comes from Romans 8, and it starts with these two sentences. What then are we to say about these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? Kind of a tricky passage when we think about all the times of confusion and challenge and distress that we face daily and weekly. It's easy in these moments to seek peace in our hearts. It's like the disciples saying, look at these stones, because they could see safety and security in those stones. We also seek safety and security insurance in these times as well. We want answers, logical answers, not later, now. We want solutions to the situation, not later, now. We want the world leaders to behave in a way that makes a difference, not later, right now. And we form opinions about who is responsible and accountable, and we want retribution against them, not later, right now. We want to alleviate our pain and confusion, and we do that in so many different ways: retail therapy, alcohol, exercise, overabundant indulgence, avoidance. We live out our own reckless abandon because our hearts are longing for a world that is not filled with reckless abandon. And we take delight in the things that we can find that satisfy us immediately, right now. One of my favorite authors, Annie Lamont, writes a blog that I read fairly frequently, and she wrote one yesterday morning. I think I've read it about 10 times. And she can say things so much better than I possibly can. So I'm going to read you part of her blog. And she's responding to the week's events and other tragic events that have happened in the world over time. What was helpful was that we stuck together in our horror, our grief, anxiety, and cluelessness. We grieved, we feared, we despaired, raged, and prayed. We reached out for any help at all. And these were appropriate responses. I'm going to recommend that we do that today and tomorrow. Wounds and trauma revealed are healed eventually. Some of us can't eat, some of us binge. Some of us can't turn off the TV, and some of us can't turn it on. And all those were appropriate. We felt badly, and we let some time pass, talk, and stuck together, and day by day, we came through it. So after an appropriate time of being stunned and in despair, we show up. Maybe we ask God for help. We do the next right thing. We buy or cook a bunch of food for the local homeless. We return phone calls, library books, and smiles. We make eye contact with others, and we go to the market and flirt with old and scary, unusual people who seem lonely. Tom Weston taught me decades ago that in the face of human tragedy, we go around the neighborhood and pick up litter, even though there will be more tomorrow. We take action, and the insight will follow. We are basically powerless, but we are not hopeless. Things are much wilder, weirder, richer, and more profound than I'm comfortable. The paradox is that we live in the reality of this, and we discover in the smallest moments of amazement our own crabby stamina and kindness to lonely people who worry us, and we weep. The tragedies of life have happened all throughout time. It's one of the things that I find somewhat discouraging in reading the Bible. It's like we humans have learned the lesson. Nation rises against nation, kingdom against kingdom. Earthquakes and famines happen. And today we have it right here, right now, in our faces because of 24/7 news coverage. And you even have a choice as to which of the talking heads you listen to give their slant on what has happened. Our minds and hearts are filled with accurate and inaccurate reporting. There is both gift and curse in that awareness. Because we so know so much, we have the ability to walk alongside others and pray for them. And that's a great thing. Because we know so much, we have the ability to dive into a more deep, morose state of being. That is not such a great thing. Theologian Frederick Buechner says, "Here is the world. Beautiful and terrible things will happen. Do not be afraid." Living with uncertainty was very difficult for the first century disciples. It's just as hard for us, the disciples of the 21st century. What then do we say about these things? If God is for us, who is against us? The promise God offers us in Christ is not that if we work hard enough, are pious enough, make ourselves acceptable enough, that all our insecurities and fears and the tragedies of the world will be left behind. Our faith does not offer an end to the scariness of the world, but rather it promises that we can discover who we are in relation to whose we are. We are beloved children of God. It turns out that the antidote to uncertainty isn't certainty, but courage. And the best response to insecurity is the confidence that comes from knowing that we belong to God, always and forever. And when we are rooted in those promises, we are better equipped to reject and resist all those people who would give us easy answers, because we know who and whose we are. And then we can live in reckless abandon, creating a world that is filled with love, hope, and peace. Because Jesus says this is just the beginning of the birth pains, meaning this is the beginning of new life. The new life we find in Him and Him alone, the one who calls us each by name. Amen. Today we celebrate with Cora Ann her baptism. I have some official sounding words, and they are important words because they remind us that we are part of a bigger family, a worldwide, oh, and she's smiling, oh my goodness. It's awesome. She's happy about this, apparently. That's a good thing. It reminds us that we are part of a bigger family, and it reminds us that we are not alone. God, who is rich in mercy and love, gives us a new birth into a living hope through the sacrament of baptism. By water and the word, God delivers us from sin and death and raises us to new life in Jesus Christ. We are united with all the baptized in the one body of Christ, anointed with the gift of the Holy Spirit, and joined in God's mission for the life of the world. So called by the Holy Spirit and trusting in the grace and love of God, do you desire to have Cora baptized into Christ? If so, say, we do.
We do.
As you bring her to receive the gift of baptism, you are entrusted with responsibilities to live with her among God's faithful people, to bring her the word of God and the Holy Supper, to teach her the Lord's Prayer, the Creed, and the Ten Commandments, to place in their hands the Holy Scriptures and nurture her in faith and prayer, so that your child may learn to trust God, proclaim Christ through word and deed, care for others in the world God make, and work for justice and peace. Do you promise to help your child grow in the Christian faith and life? If so, say we do.
We do.
And sponsors, do you promise to nurture Cora in the Christian faith as you are empowered by God's Spirit to help her live in the covenant of her baptism and in communion with the church? If so, say we do. And people of God, that's the rest of us here. Do you promise to support Cora and pray for her in her new life in Christ? If so, enthusiastically say, we do.
We do.
I invite you to stand. I'm going to ask all of us to profess our faith in Christ Jesus, to reject sin and confess the faith of the church. First, do you renounce the devil and all the forces that defy God, the powers of this world that rebel against God, and the ways of sin that draw you from God? If so, say, I renounce them.
I renounce them.
Do you believe in God the Father? I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God? I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. Do you believe in God the Holy Spirit? I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. Let us pray. Holy God, holy and merciful, holy and mighty, you are the river of life, you are the everlasting wellspring, you are the fire of rebirth. Glory to you for oceans and lakes, for rivers and streams. Honor to you for cloud and rain, for dew and snow. Your waters are below us, around us, above us. Our life is born in you. You are the fountain of resurrection. Praise to you for your saving waters. Noah and the animals survived the flood. Hagar discovers your well. The Israelites escape through the sea, and they drink from your gushing rock. Naaman washes his leprosy away, and the Samaritan woman will never be thirsty again. At this font, holy God, we pray. Praise to you for the water of baptism and for your word that saves us in this water. Breathe your spirit into all who are gathered here and into all creation. Illumine our days, enliven our bones, dry our tears. Wash away the sin within us and drown the evil around us. Satisfy all your thirst with your living water, Jesus Christ, our Savior, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. All right. Cora Ann, drink water. I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray. We give you thanks, O God, that through water and the Holy Spirit you give your daughters and sons new birth. Cleanse them from sin and raise them to eternal life. Sustain Cora Ann with the gift of your Holy Spirit, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the spirit of joy in your presence, both now and forever. Cora Ann, child of God, you have been sealed with the power of the Holy Spirit and marked with the cross of Christ forever. Amen.
Let your light so shine before others that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven.
So I would like to introduce to you our newest little sister in the body of Christ, Cora. And I think you should welcome her with a round of applause. You belong to Christ, in whom you have been baptized. You belong to Christ, in whom you have been baptized. Alleluia, alleluia. You belong to Christ, in whom you have been baptized. We have witnessed a miracle, and the miracle of life. And though you can't see it, she has been sealed with that cross of Christ now and forever, and nothing, nothing, nothing can separate her from Christ. She's having a good time looking at all you guys. That's all I'm going to say. Yeah. So I have a bag here for, you can blow the candle out if you'd like, of things for you and for Cora. There is a blanket made by our knitters in this church to remind you that she is surrounded by the love and care of this church. And also there is a CD of music for her to learn some songs that she'll later be learning in Journey of Faith.
Thank you.
God go with you.
Now let us pray. United into one God by the power of the Holy Spirit, let us pray with all God's saints for healing, wholeness, and peace in all the earth. Holy One, we pray for healing in the church, for forgiveness when we are quick to judge, for mercy when we are slow to love our neighbors. Let us pray. Have mercy, O God. For stars and planets and all the wonders of the universe, for the renewal of all God's creation, today we remember those recovering from earthquakes in Japan and Mexico and the mudslides in China. Let us pray. For political refugees and all who seek asylum, for war-torn nations and our global neighbors accustomed to the sound of bombs and gunfire, especially in Baghdad, Syria, Paris, and Beirut. Let us pray. For those without a prayer to pray, those who no longer have homes to defend, the despairing, the hungry, those facing their last days on earth, and the sick and recovering, especially Bee, Pat, Oliver, Janine, Ron, Irene, Ruby, Edith, and Diane. Let us pray. We thank you for the gift of new life given to us in our baptism. Today we especially remember Cora Ann. May she be your light in the world. Let us pray. In thanksgiving for all the faithful departed who now sing your glory, may our voices join with their praise today and always. Today we place into your care George Wilson and Deanna Hansen. Let us pray. Into your care, Alpha and Omega, we entrust all for whom we pray. Be with us now and always, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. May the peace of Jesus Christ be with us always. Please share that peace with those around you.
We now prepare our hearts and our minds for the gift of the meal. And the night before he died, our Lord and Savior took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your love and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. This is the Lord's table, and you are all welcome here, for the gifts of God are free. You may be seated. invite you to stand. And now may the body and blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ, give you strength and peace today and into your life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray. O God, our life, our strength, our food, we give you thanks for sustaining us with the body and blood of your Son. By your Holy Spirit, enliven us to be his body in the world, that more and more we will give you praise and serve your earth and its many peoples. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. And now, until we meet again, receive this benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine upon you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and grant you peace. Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.